My name is Angus Rowland. Everybody calls me Gus. I'm the operations manager and senior hydrogeologist for Pitto Associates based in Johannesburg. Pitto Associates is a geotechnical and mine water management specialist technical consulting firm. Established in 1976, we are 140 people in 11 offices in 7 countries globally. And we work for 9 of the world's top 10 miners and have worked on over 2,000 projects in the last 40 plus years. Mine water management is a relatively recent addition to the group, although hydrogeology has been looked at over the years. But since 2016, the mine water management group has been focusing on practical aspects of water management for mining companies especially, and that's focused on absolutely everything from hydrogeology to hydrology, surface water and groundwater, dewatering, geochemistry, closure, and all aspects of basically anything related to mine water management. So this afternoon's talk is going to be on the applications of modeling for mine water management, mostly focused on hydrogeological modeling. And Florent Baudet is going to be our presenter this afternoon. He's a hydrogeologist based in France and operates through our UK office. Florent has an MSc in geological engineering with a specialization in water resources. He's also got over 9 years of consulting experience focusing predominantly on mining hydrogeology. Overall, he specializes in groundwater modeling with applications especially on environmental impact assessments, open pit mine depressurization and dewatering, as well as significant inputs to bankable and pre-feasibility studies. He's got experience with all of the main simulation codes and tools, predominantly ModFlow and FeeFlow, as well as SeepW, and works extensively with the latest FeeFlow 7 and ModFlow USG unstructured grid systems, and has worked on projects throughout Europe, South America, Sub-Saharan Africa, and USA. The list of countries is a bit too long to include here. So Florent, if you'd like to take it away. Oh, and a last thing, any questions, please do add them in the chat in text. Feel free to put them in during the talk and we will address all questions at the end. Thanks very much, Florent. Good luck.
Yeah, thank you, Gus, for the introduction. So you can see my presentation and my pointer.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so let's go. Yeah, so yeah, it's thank you very much for attending this last presentation, this series of webinar. We will deal with groundwater modeling. And it will be, to some extent, an echo to the first presentations where we have seen some problems that mine operators have in open pits or underground mines, for instance. And we will see how numerical modeling can help in addressing those problems and help to find some solutions. So this presentation, it will be, I will try to keep it short, an introduction to numerical modeling, even if there is a lot to say, but it's to focus mainly on the different applications and what we do for the mining industry in terms of applied hydrogeology. There is a possibility to extend with some discussions on some aspects of modeling. We will see if we have time to reach this point. But the main objective is to see the applications of numerical models. So in the detail, the mining industry is characterized by the extraction of minerals, either in pits or underground mines. So the ends with groundwater system is it's generally the core of our activity. It's to focus the modeling on open pits and underground mines, but we also study the mine site as an integrated series of installations, and we have the West Rock dumps and the tailing dams that are generally in the vicinity of the extraction zone, and that can have an influence on the open pits, for instance, or can generate some problem from an environmental perspective. And groundwater modeling can also assist in providing some understanding and solutions regarding the installations. Obviously, you need a lot of water, and generally you have a well field or to extract groundwater. So there is also a lot of work done with well feeds. And here you have a leach pad. It's a very exceptional, so we will not cover this today. It's exceptional because normally a leach pad is lined, and you should not have any problem of contamination with leach pads. But sometimes, mainly due to operational issues with pools, safety ponds, some discharge, you could have problem of with some contaminants. But the main focus in terms of installations from an environmental perspective, it will be the West Rock dams and the tailing dams. Okay, so groundwater models. If we have to explain what is it, it's it will be a simplified representation of the groundwater system. And to do that, we will endorse the groundwater model to a conceptual model. A conceptual model, it's a summary of the main component of discharge and recharge, and the main characteristic of the groundwater system. And we will use it to see what is the interaction between this natural system and the mine facilities. So we use numerical models with computers, and we all know why we use computers. It's because they are very good for calculations. They are very good to store information. We can capture all the complexity of a mine site, all the complexity of a proposed mine plan, for instance, in a 3D model. The objective of a groundwater model, it's to be a tool to do predictions. There is a fact that the numerical model is under conceptual model, and there is also the fact that the predictive value of this numerical model, it's obtained following a rigorous procedure, a workflow that includes, among all, the calibration. The calibration will enable to show that we manage to reproduce historical behavior observed, and we will use this as a support to for the numerical predictions. At this point, we have to be careful about the definition of objectives, and I will insist on the fact it's a tool and it's to do predictions, and it's not to understand something. It's not to create parameters, because basically a groundwater model, it's doing what we are asking, and we have to be conscious that we can obtain exactly what we want or what we ask. And we should focus the model on doing prediction and not on trying to understand some things. We could discuss a lot about this, but I just want to underline this. groundwater models are almost compulsory from a permitting perspective today. If you are showing an environmental impact assessment in some countries and jurisdictions without any mechanical model for a mine, it will not be accepted. And even at PFS or FS study, it will be generally required, if not by the jurisdiction, by the management team to get more details, a more complex tool. And here I want to discuss about the complexity. Numerical models, it's perhaps the most complex part or the most complex tool to do predictions, and you have other tools before that can be used. You have analytical models and formulas that could work very well. You have also the experience of people, the benchmarking, and those formula, for instance, the analytical formula derived from the well hydraulic, they will work very well. If you don't have a lot of data, they will give you a first assessment, and very quickly, if you compare to a numerical model. So from an operational perspective, it's also important to see what are all the options. From an environmental perspective, it's almost compulsory. You start to have guidelines to show the path to follow in terms of model constructions and some standardization for the construction simulations, presentations of results. Mainly for impact assessments, when you have many mines showing different things with different methodology, it's certainly difficult for the authorities to assess. So there are some trend to the standardization, and with a lot of information within those guidelines to establish successful project in terms of modeling. So that's a general procedure. I will go very quickly, but first of all, before to start anything with a numerical model, you have to define your objectives. You will collect information and you will review all the available information, and you will build your conceptual model. After that, you start to have the phase of modeling with a construction and a phase of simulation. The phase of construction, it's basically constructing the architecture of your model, the grid, the model area, the layers. You will assign the boundary conditions and you will assign the material properties, which are for groundwater modeling, mainly hydraulic conductivity, storage, all the parameters associated to flow in the porous medium. In terms of simulation, once your model is built, you will calibrate and validate with historical data, hopefully, if you have. You will run sensitivity analysis and uncertainty analysis. And after, you will run the predictions considering all the uncertainties of your model. And based on that, you will present the result and show it in function of the objectives of your model. So the conceptual model, it's the base of your numerical model. And the stronger is your conceptual model, the stronger will be your numerical model, and it will also generally imply that the more time you invest in your conceptual model, less time you will lose in your numerical model, mainly at the stage of the evaluation of uncertainties and mainly generally the uncertainties. And the other aspect, the calibration. So as I said before in the introduction, the calibration, it's associated with the validation. It's to give a predictive value to your model, and the idea is to fit the parameters of your model to adjust those parameters and to match the observations, which will be the observed water levels in groundwater monitoring holes, the base flow in your river, the extraction rate in your well field, for instance. And the general trend is to do a steady state model with pre-mining data, a transient calibration with a historical mine, and based on those two models, it's to run a prediction. You have different ways of doing this calibration. You have a manual way with a trial and error method, or using automated methods like PEST, which is the reference in groundwater modeling. What we have to take into account is that a model is a combination of parameters, and different combinations of parameters can give the same result. And we have to focus the work on the definition of parameters and restrict the range of parameters to limit the number of non-unique solutions. And here the professional judgment, the solid conceptual model are very important to constrain the numerical model. Basically, we will assess the calibration from a qualitative and quantitative point of view, and we will or in function of the data we have. So just a quick view of calibration from a numerical model. If you look at a steady state model, what you will try to show is that the simulated levels are very similar to the measured level. And for that, you have this this line of perfect fit. And you will try to get the point as close as possible of your line. If you are looking at a transient calibration, so over time, here you have the simulated in blue. The orange is some punctual measurement in some wells. It's for a well field, an area of a well field, and the observation is that level decrease and increase again after due to a change in the flow rate of a pumping well in the vicinity. And here we have the simulation in transient of this observation. So it's not perfect, but the behavior is captured basically in the numerical model. So a quick overview of the software. So CIPW, it's one of the software we'll use for mainly for 2D sections and 1D modeling actually. It's now with a version 3D, so we could have a cross here, but it's very new. We don't have experience in that, but probably in a few years, if I show you again this table, it will be a standard. Perhaps we will see what happened. FIFLO for finite element models, it's a standard software that can be used for 2D section, but it's mostly used for 3D modeling. And you have ModFlow. ModFlow, it's not a software, it's a code. You have different codes. You have public one, you have a private one, Surfact, you have to pay for that, but you can run Modflow USG for free. The only problem is how you run Modflow, and you will probably need a groundwater user interface. So you have some free groundwater user interface, but the most popular one are from private companies, so you have to pay for. And you can do a 2D, but it will be 2D plan view mostly. And we almost use Modflow only for 3D modeling. The only trend between those software I would like outline, you know, it's the clear ease of use. See if it's very easy to use. It's a 2D, it's a simple interface. And as you go to Modflow, Modflow USG, the fact it's modular, so you have a lot of input file, output files. The fact it's modular, each information is in a specific place, and it requires certainly sometimes to be familiar with this type of code. You have other software to do groundwater modeling, Hydroid, mainly for to include climatic information. It's a recognized tool. SVFlux is very similar to GeoSlope that is developing SIP. And MindDW developed by Itasca that is showing a good results for the simulation of open pits. But it's something you can do with FIFLOW or ModFlow without any problems. Okay, so we will start with the application. Sorry, it was too long, but the groundwater modeling will be focused on the pore pressure and evaluation of dewatering rate. To do reference to the first presentation on the open pit, the big problem for with the groundwater in the pit slopes, it's the pore pressure and the fact that you have water close to your pit wall, it will decrease the effective stress and the shear stress, and it applies for the pit slope stability for the fault. The shear stress associated to the faults, it will decrease the stability near the pit wall. And considering the fact that the pore pressure is the only parameter you can modify for the stability analysis, you won't modify the property of your rock because the property of your rock is what it is. If there is something to do to improve your slope stability, it's to work with the pore pressure. And that's something we can do easily in 2D, for instance, here, with different units and different properties from the conceptual model. And we will simulate the distribution of the water table and the associated head and pressure behind the pit slope. And we will be able to include some drainage installed, like horizontal drain, in the pit wall. The thing is, this type of exercise, it's generally it's always to provide an input to the geotech teams that are working on the slope stability because. They are doing some calculations on the slope stability, and they need an input for the pore pressure. And they could work without our input, but it will be probably not realistic. And you have different assumptions to start to run your model of stability with a constant offset behind your wall. You can apply some rules like here, mid slope or at a first third, you have an offset of 150 meters. It's totally subjective. And after, generally, the other assumption is a homogeneous distribution of the pore pressure behind the water phreatic surface. The thing is, when we calculate the pore pressure distribution in a numerical model, we are much more accurate with sensors generally, and we will get different spacing for the pore pressure lines, for instance, here, if you are upslope, midslope, or just at the base of your pit. And the consequence of using this, it's a different factor of safety, perhaps in the good direction or the bad direction. And but it's probably more realistic, and that's why it's interesting to use inputs of groundwater models for slope stability analysis in geotech. The trend initially it was to do. Because it was easy to build, quite quick to obtain some results, and to integrate complex features in like faults that are not perfectly vertical. The trend is now to use 3D models because the need for section increased over time, and the size of the pits, of the big pits in South America, North America, changed a lot. And now the number of sections, it reached a point where the number of 2D sections, here you have an example in with purple lines, it makes complex to do 2D models. So the trend is to go to 3D models and integrate the mine plan. As you can see here, you have a sequence of excavation. And it's made possible by the unstructured mesh that has been introduced in FIFLOW some years ago, and MudFlow USG also, that does not oblige us to work in a row column. You have also the fact that geological model, like the models developed with LeapFrog or GeoModeler, there is a good interoperability with those 3D models and the softwares. Basically, they did a good work to facilitate the inputs of block models, so the properties in 3D are easily imported, and it's now very easy to import complex features and complex geometries in terms of the associated to the geology in a 3D model. Okay, so the in terms of results, we will compare different scenarios, and we will use the model as a tool to do some predictions. So one of the things in the 2D section is to see the effect of horizontal and eventually tunnels, and you will with a 3D model. Here you have a comparative scenario scenarios. For predictions with dewatering wells, horizontal drains, and eventually a tunnel with drains. So the idea is still to be reasonable, and even if it's a tool you can do with whatever you want with, it's to avoid science fiction. And if horizontal drain worked very well to maintain the pore pressure, the phreatic surface away of your pit wall, because you are in a low conductivity low storage environment, you will probably continue with horizontal drains, and you will use a numerical model to optimize the placement of drains, the number of drains. But yeah, you could try whatever you want, basically. But the idea is to stay with reasonable solutions, and pumping well horizontal drains, it's the most common solutions that will be explored. After you can assess in function of the option you choose the effect on the groundwater surface for different periods. And obviously if you do a big tunnel with some drain, it's the more efficient, but after it's a trade-off in terms of solutions and costs. But that's the type of answer a numerical model can give. the advantage after for 3D model, it's that you can choose any direction of, in your model to create a 2D section if some specific stability analysis in 2D is required. And here I want just to do a small discussion on the mine plans. You have to include in your workflow in the construction of your model the fact that the mine plan can change. And here we see that we have some pixels, and we have to be capable of changing that if the mine plan change, because that's the reality of mining. It's when you if you do a complex model and it takes you 3 months, probably the day you finish to calibrate and run start to run the prediction, the and you have is out of date. So you can do like here I was showing very fancy models showing exactly the pitch health, but you have also to be careful on the flexibility of your model to adapt new pitch health and not start again from scratch basically. Okay, after for underground mines, so the other interesting area, we will be able in a groundwater model to simulate the ingress of groundwater to the tunnels. So here you have a series of tunnels. The deposit is almost a vertical vein. And we are missing the shaft, but basically you have a series of tunnels and we are simulating it in FIFLOW. And we get an oscillation, but an average of 120 liters per second. And it's very similar to what is pumped from the mine. It's not exactly what is pumped from the mine, but you have to remind that in the mine you have some sumps, you have the time for some water to reach the sumps. So between the peak of inflow observed in the part of the mine and the fact it's pumped outside of the mine, you might have some delay. But here we have a satisfying calibration. And if you have a cross-section view, you can see the effect of the simulated underground mine on the hydraulic head or the pore pressure. The interest here of having simulated the ingress of groundwater, it's after to include additional levels and see what are the area of preferential inflow and eventually do some recommendations on the design of the mine. If we have to put some shotcrete and specific sections, that will be true, not necessarily if you go deeper, but if you have a decline going through some weathered rock, for instance, or a fractured zone. But that's the kind of thing also you can have. After you have a small complex configuration, it's block caving, where you have some tunnels, and at some point you have a extraction level. It will be a platform with some small tunnels, a specific design with some draw point where with some blasting they will start to fragmentate the rock above the extraction level and collect it in the extraction level. And the idea is that if you have a vertical ore body like a cylinder, it's to focus the extraction of rock only on this ore body. So you will minimize the amount of waste rock by extracting a lot of rock here. Obviously, there will be a deficit and of material, and you will create a subsidence zone or a crater. And over time, this crater will develop from the extraction level, and it will go up and probably up to the surface, even if you have a some extraction levels up to 1 kilometer of depth or more. And here, from a hydrogeological perspective, it's quite challenging because you have the tunnel, but you also have this at the end, this big fractured zone. It's it will be a mobilized rock with a much higher permeability than the surrounding fresh bedrock. You will have a transition due to the unloading and the. It will not be a clear contact, but basically you will have a connection between your extraction level and the surface. And if the block caving is occurring after a period with open pits, it will be generally below the open pit, and we will collect all the water of the open pit directly in the subsidence zone and subsequently in the extraction zone. In that case, it's at the top of the mountain, so you will collect water only on this crater. But you will create a direct connection with the surface, basically. So, in terms of inflow, you will have to consider the fact that you have a cave zone that will grow over time. It will reach shallower units like the weathered bedrock and the alluvial units. So that's why you are expecting a peak at some point. And after, you will continue to receive some water laterally and from the top, considering that the subsidence zone will probably increase over time, and the influence of surface water to the water you are collecting here will increase. So here it's a view of the tunnel with the extraction level here, and inside this cylinder you have the caved material, and the white surface, it's the phreatic surface that is developed around the caved zone, and here it's only the phreatic surface around the topography. I did to speak about the hydromechanical coupling. And we have seen that the damage produced by the caved zone, it will totally change the property of the rock. And from a fresh bedrock, we will have a fragmented rock, and it will change the distribution of the water near the extraction level. And the consequence is the groundwater model is totally dependent of the geotech input. So there is an interdependency between the hydrogeology and the geotech models. And it's particularly obvious for block caving because, as I said, you have this big caved and fractured zone. You have also the subsidence crater that will modify the hydrogeology, the shallower units. You have the fact that you are reducing the stress in the wall of your caved zone, so you can have the dilation of faults. And the mix of water and fine material could produce some bed rush, and it's a big problem in block caving, big problem to predict also. At the moment, considering all the uncertainties about the property of your material in the block cave, except the fact it's high permeability material, we are not able to predict mud rush in a numerical model. But it's basically the fact that the fine material is with a high water content, and it will behave as a mud. Wave basically in the extraction level as a liquid instead of only being a fragmented rock. After for open pit, you have also the reduction of stress that will modify the property for the flow and the unloading could increase the storage, for instance, and the same for the faults. And after you have the tailing dam, and it's the contrary, it's not a reduction, it's an increase of stress, and it will be the compaction of tailings if you are considering tailings with a significant height. Compaction of tailings might have a significant role. Actually, we will speak about tailings now. So tailings, it's to store all the fines from the process plant. For tailings, the use of tailings storage facility, the condenser model will be used to evaluate seepage rate and the propagation of contaminant. So here I have a workflow. It's very complicated, but I will summarize very to generate a plume of contaminant and evaluate the environmental impact. What you need, it's two things: it's the quality and the quantity. And I will deal with 1D model after, but we will generally develop 2D models, cross sections of the tailing TSF to evaluate the seepage flux, the behavior in the embankment. We will evaluate the how it conveys what solution in the underlying units. We'll probably try to reconcile with a water balance for the TSF. Most of the TSF have a water balance only for to evaluate the storage capacity, but this water balance, it will be also used to evaluate the quality, because you have to consider what is the inflow, the discharge from the plant, what is the effect of meteorological input, like the evaporation, how much data is extracted, how much data, how much water is added with rainfall, for instance. And that will be necessary to evaluate the quality of your seepage. If you know how much is reaching the base of your TSF and what is the quality, after you can introduce in a 3D model, flow model, and you will develop a transport model over it, to get a plume of contaminant. So here we have a quick example with an embankment and different elevation of tailings with the final one. It's a quite simple design, but just to evaluate the flow in the underlying unit. And into the groundwater seat. So here we have the result in 3D, and as it's a numerical model, it's a tool, and we can do some scenarios. It's not costing anything. It's done for that. So we can assess different options of deposition. We can assess different options of remediation. Very quickly, here it's a plume of sulfate, so it's conservative, it's only advection dispersion, but you can complexify much more the model with some reaction. It will be a retardation for your numerical model, but in reality it will be a precipitation of arsenic, for instance, with the iron hydroxide that is in the laterite. And from a conservative perspective, if for sulfate you have this, for arsenic it can be a totally different story, and you will see absolutely nothing outside of the footprint of the TSF, for instance. So you have a different level of complexity, obviously. Another type of waste, it's the waste rock dumps. So overburden material, non-acid generating material, or potentially acid generating materials. And what seems simple here as a dump of rocks, it's in reality quite complex if you look in detail. And just by the architecture of the waste rock dump, the deposition with the creation of platforms, the segregation of blocks when it's deposited, So the movement of water inside your waste rocket dump is complex. What is also very complex is what is occurring at the surface. And when you look at the surface, obviously the main inflow is the rainfall. You will avoid to get lateral inflow, and it can be easily avoided by channels. But what you can't avoid is rainfall. And the challenge here is to know what is the recharge that will enter your waste rock dump. To the difference of TSF, it's generally unsaturated, so you don't have a lot of water inside your waste rock dump. What you have a lot, it's oxygen. So the big problem here is to know what is the portion of water that is entering the waste rock dump, because the process of oxidation can be very important in some cases and produce very bad quality seepage. So from rainfall, you have runoff. If you have a very strong rainfall event, you have a small portion that will directly evaporate. You have a portion that will infiltrate and subsequently re-evaporate until the extinction depths. After that, it will only go downward. The evaporation has no longer effect, and you can consider that all the water that reaches this point is recharged. So as I said, the big challenge is to know how much water enters your waste rock dump, and you can evaluate the recharge at surface and see how it. If you have a very big waste rock dump, it's what is the movement of water inside your waste rock dump? It's unsaturated materials, and it's slightly different to saturated models, in the sense that it's your hydraulic conductivity and the associated volume water content will vary in function of the suction. And it's quite complex in reality. It's at the limit of hydrogeology, geotechnique, and agro science. And it's like going back to school to some extent, because other way of seeing the problems. For instance, to determine the property of your material, it's not anymore pumping test. It will be some collection of samples. You will determine the grain size distribution, the hydraulic conductivity at saturation, but also for different level of saturations. And with some models, you can establish some curves of properties in function of the degree of saturation, basically. It's complex, but and actually the modeling of 1D columns is sometimes more complex than 3D models. And in those 1D models, we will simulate the what occurs at the interface between the climate and your material. So it can be a waste rock dump, it can be a reclaimed TSF that is not anymore fully saturated. And you will apply the climatic boundary condition at the top, and you will see how the porous medium here is storing the rainfall event, releasing it by evaporation and letting the water going down. What you will produce is some curves of cumulative flow. Here it's the cumulative rainfall over the 10 years we evaluate, and we will see what is the portion that is going to be outflow as evaporation and runoff. And the if you subtract the runoff and the evaporation, you will know the portion of water that is infiltrating the waste rock dump, basically. Those models, it will be also used for rehabilitation, and here the idea is not to invent the wheel. In terms of rehabilitation, in function of the climate and the area, you have a type of rehabilitation that will be appropriate, and generally for it will be store and release or watershedding. And the numerical is appropriate to evaluate the scenario, and it will be also the sickness, because you have some restriction on site and you can't do something of 20 meter to cap your waste rock dump or your tailings. You have to be realistic and 1 to 2 meters of material over your tailings or waste rock dump. It's generally what you try to get because you don't have the material to do more, basically. So you will add those materials with some other properties, and you will see the effect that the climatic conditions have in terms of infiltration to the at the base of your column. The objective is generally to avoid big runoff, so erosion, and to avoid the infiltration below the extension depths. Okay, so we have seen different facilities, and here we will see environmental impact assessment. And generally, in the model for environmental impact assessment, it's a reconciliation of all those models. We will include the pit, and we will also include the waste rock and the TSF, for instance. Well, in that case, the focus is on the pit, but we have the type of model domain we use for environmental impact assessment. It's generally based on catchment limits, and we will try to use the geology of the regional geology, because it's big models over 20 by 20 kilometers, for instance. So much larger than the block model, and locally we will try to use a block model to have a very precise representation of the geology or alteration or mineralization, whatever is the parameter you choose to discretize your hydrogeological unit in this area. It will be a long process, but generally always starting by a steady state calibration, preferably in conditions. You will try to simulate, for instance, a vehicle operation. So you will have some data over the last 10 years here, and you will try to reproduce what is observed on site. And based on that, you have a model to run some predictions. What type of prediction are you doing? It's quite simple. Some for environmental impact assessment, you are interested in a variation of levels. So it will be a drawdown associated to the excavation of your pit, and you will see for some specific target, some observation points, what is the depletion, but also the recovery on the very long term after the mine ends, for instance. Another thing you want to see is the effect of this excavation on the surrounding ecosystems, for instance, the base flow discharge to the natural drainage system downstream, and you will see by checking what is the variation of discharge over time in function of different scenarios. That's generally what is asked to show. For waste rock dumps, if you are not very clear about the quality, or you still have a lot of uncertainties, what you can at least do is some particle tracking. So you will release some particles here, and you will just check the flow path. Basically, you won't know what is the quality downstream, but you will know what will be the affected areas. So it's a first assessment. The next step generally is to associate a quality to your artificial recharge component. And when you have quality, it's a transport model. And as I said, with TSF, you can have conservative advection dispersion models. And you can go to very complex models if you have reactive contaminants. Here it's an example, and in that case, if you have an observation point downstream, you can assess the quality over time. the last slide on that, it's for well fields. It's generally outside of the mine area, and the main thing that will be asked is to show what is the impact on levels. So again, it's a drawdown. It's another magnitude of drawdown, obviously compared to an open pit, but it's to compare what is the drawdown and compare it with the location of protected receptors. So that's something that has to be defined as part of the environmental impact assessments. I will finish here with a quick summary. With the time required to develop models, without considering the time to prepare conceptual models and reviewing information, it can be very different. So we have to keep in mind that it can go from weeks to years, and strictly in time required for modeling 2D section, it will be relatively easy, and we will get also for 1D modeling first results quite quickly. For open pits in 3D, it will be at least months. And for environmental impact assessment, it can take years, and that's not only modeling, it's also after all the decisions to on the scenarios, on the assumptions, and it's a very long process. But obviously it's not years in front of a model, but the time between starting a model and presenting it can be very, very long. So that's a general overview of what can be done for the mining industry. Gus, do I have time to do a quick discussion? Or should we stop?
Up to you, Florent. We've got a couple of questions from people. How many more slides have you got?
Five.
I think let's go for another 5 minutes, if that's okay. And we'll go through questions after.
Yeah,
that's all good.
Yeah, I will go quickly, but it's something I prepared in case, but it's only focused on area of improvements. And the first one, it's uncertainties. How we deal with uncertainties, and it's inherent to the work we do, and not only from a hydrogeological perspective, but from mineral resource to geotech, we have to deal with uncertainties, and it's something we are not doing very well, and we should improve. The thing is also the time dedicated to that. It's perhaps because we don't want to show how bad is our model, but at the same time the client wants a number, so there is a sort of consensus, but we should focus much more on uncertainties, and because in the models there are a lot of uncertainties. Models, it's mainly due to the structures. We are not sure on 100% of the location of the faults, of the limits of the units. We have an idea. We are doing a simplification with a conceptual model, but we have a lot of uncertainty about this. We know some parameter from punctual hydraulic tests, but we don't have a precise idea for every cubic centimeter of what is the property of the material. You have heterogeneities and you have to deal with that. And if you consider all the errors for the like measurement of properties, like with the hydraulic test, all the errors associated to the measurement of groundwater level in a monitoring well, and the error associated to the weather stations, you have a lot of error in all the inputs you receive. And the last error, it's about the scenarios. We generally consider that the future stress is under a constant condition, And that's to do a comparative scenario between do something and do nothing, for instance. What happens if we put a pit and if we don't put an open pit? But the reality is the future is not clear, in the sense you have climate change, you have the land use, the population, water using by other users that will change. So the condition outside of your open pit, your TSF and your waste rock dump will change over time. And that's my point here. The thing is, it's very complex to deal with uncertainties. Quantification, some people are spending their life on that. But a good way of applying this, it's by looking at what is done with PEST, for instance. PEST is used for the calibration, but you can do a lot for the uncertainty analysis. You have a lot of resources that has been developed in Australia by the NCGRT, and I recommend highly to check this and to see how you apply uncertainty quantification to the numerical models. And for groundwater modeling, a trend it's to have a probabilistic approach. It's to see your input parameters. You will have, for instance, for your hydraulic conductivity, a range of hydraulic conductivity. Here you have different distribution, and you will choose between the mean and the max hydraulic conductivity for one unit. You will choose the distribution of this, and you will take in this distribution one parameter, one number. You will assign it to the numerical model, and you will see the result. And if you have different parameters in your model, you will do a random combination of parameters assigned to your model, and you will see the result. What you can do is the random combination of parameters to your model and see what is the calibration. You do a manual calibration, you have a good calibration, but here you can have another combination of parameters that will produce also a very good calibration. So probably also a very valid model, because it's within the range of parameters you have given to your model. And even if it's providing a good calibration, so something close to your base case model, perhaps the predictions are very different. And it's very important to explore those different predictions, the range of prediction it's giving, and after try to reduce those uncertainties. How you can do that? It's by doing a sensitivity analysis. You will check which parameter is very important for the model result or for the observation you want to assess. For instance, here the parameter 11 determine a lot the result in your observation. So if you focus the next investigations on restricting, constraining this parameter in terms of geometry and property, perhaps you will reduce the range of possibility. And that's something that has been highlighted by the NCGRT in Australia. You have this traditional workflow where you collect data, you build your model, you do some predictions, and you assess the uncertainty. But perhaps it's a workflow that will take 3 months. Perhaps what you can do is to build your model and start with uncertainty instead of waiting to have predictions. It's to say before to do prediction, I will tell that the things we have to constrain, where we have to collect more data because it's producing too much uncertainty to the model. And with that, after we can run the predictions. And again, it's the numerical model is a tool, and here it's a good opportunity to use it as a tool to improve the understanding of the predictions. Obviously, there is judgment, but there are mathematical solutions that prove the different parameters to constrain. So here it's just an example with four different versions of model, different combination of parameters, giving different type of results. The other thing I want to speak, it's about climate change. So here It's for the region of Johannesburg. So you have the temperatures and the precipitation projection for the last 20 years, between 2080 and 2100. For two scenarios, the scenario RCP 2.6 and 8.5, this is with in the detail, it's if we are, if a human being is reasonable or if a human being continue to do what he is doing. The consequence is we will if we are reasonable, it's between 1 and 1.5 degrees Celsius above the what we have today. If it's the worst scenario, the what is expected, it's 4 degrees. And that's the average of several models, more than 10 models developed in different countries. So you have a range, the uncertainty, but you have a trend that is giving 4 degrees for the temperature. For the precipitation, it's not obvious, and I think it's the same for everywhere in the world. So trend is a change in temperature, an increase in temperature, but for precipitation, we don't know exactly what will be the consequence. But with the worst case, the general trend is a decrease of precipitation over the spring for you in Johannesburg. And here, only from an environmental impact assessment perspective, I'm doing a lot of models on environmental impact assessment, and I have never been asked to do predictions considering the climate change. I know it's done by from academics, not necessarily in mining with mining objectives, but. At some point, it will have to be taken into account, mainly because it will go in two directions. For groundwater dependent ecosystems, the fact to add a mine, but even any activity to an area that is already under a huge stress due to this global problem. It will have to be taken into account for the approval of new project, and in the other direction, perhaps at some point we will show that even without mining, for instance, the groundwater dependent ecosystems will disappear. So the fact to add a mine will change nothing to what you will have, basically, because mine is generally a local and acute problem for the environment, but it's not a global and distributed. And here it's different scales, but at the moment of assessing impact, it will be I think a big shift in the approbation of projects. That's all.
Fantastic. Thanks very much, Florent, and thanks for shooting through those things so quickly at the end. Thanks also just to the GSSA especially, and to Nolene in particular, for setting everything up. We'll go through the questions now that have been put on the chat. So my apologies in advance in case I get anybody's pronunciation of anybody's name wrong. Let me just bring up questions that we have. So the first question from Arnaud Hamidou is, have we ever used MindEW and how do we rate it?
No, unfortunately, I have not used MindEW. But I mentioned it because it seems to be nearly a standard in the software that's currently used. It's a good question. I'm not against progress, but I would recommend highly to continue with widely used software. And I put MindEW in. I think it's used by a lot of people, just because of the versatility. I think it's it's important that different people in different locations are capable of working, reviewing a model, and not working with a confidential code, basically. That's for the global use of models, and also for in terms of documentation of support. At least in the list I have given, you have a good you are guaranteed that you will get a good support, good documentation.
I can add to that actually. So in my experience with reviewing a number of models, MindDW is certainly a very versatile and very powerful code. And definitely has a place. As consultants, however, though, we tend to be focused more on software that is more widely used and more freely available to most of our clients. And the fundamental reason for that is we believe that our clients should be able to use any model that we build almost independent of the code that it's developed with. And we're reluctant to tie in a client to having to use a certain code from a certain supplier. But that being said, MindDW is very good. It is very effective. It is quite specialist, and it does need some particular skill and focus to use. Next question from Pierre Avalos, two-part question. First one is, do we have experience applying uncertainty analysis in our pore pressure models? And the second part of the question is, what software do we use for hydromechanical coupling of geotech and hydro in pore pressure models, and what frequency of data transfer between those codes do we use?
Uncertainty analysis I have specifically for pore pressure models. I have not applied for pore pressure. I applied for propagation of plume of contaminants. And as I said, the PEST, it's a toolbox, and using PEST, you can do this. I did a slide with a workflow proposed by Thomas Booth in Chile. It's a software he's developing. I've not used it, but apparently it's perfect to do this type of work, the uncertainty analysis on Modflow models, and including Modflow USG. So you can look in this direction. For hydromechanical coupling, the only software we use for this, it's a Sigma W. It's from the series of GeoSlope. After it will be if it's in Modflow or FiFlow, for instance, it will be it won't be like a perfect coupling, but we will establish some rules basically of rock damage in function, or hydraulic conductivity in function of the rock damage. For the block caves, in the cave zone, there are a lot of uncertainties. There is not a lot of information and to do some benchmarking. And to be honest, there is a lot of analytical or empirical formulas we could look to develop this hydromechanical couplings, but it's most of the time associated to the loading, to the increase of stress. You have very few ones except perhaps with the porosity when you decrease the you reduce the stress. So no, it's not easy, but we try generally by analytical, empirical formula that we apply to the hydro model.
Thanks very much, Florent. I think, Pierre, I can add to that in some description is also the need for very close interrelationship and interaction between the hydrogeology and the geotech teams. What we've often found is the most effective way of evaluating these kinds of hydromechanical coupled models is to work in an iterative manner between the geotechnical team and the hydrogeological team, so that there's a free flow of data and understanding of systems behavior between the two teams. quite often in the past, we've come across clients that have attempted to run hydrogeological and geotechnical models for slope stability completely in isolation with very little interaction between the two teams. And that's always a recipe for disaster. Fundamentally, having a good interaction between the teams and good flow of data makes a massive difference. And even in the event that you can't or don't have access to truly coupled hydromechanical data models, you're able to achieve a similar outcome by having good interaction between the teams. Thanks again, Flavon. Next question from Gani Nesibekov. He asks, or she asks, what do you think is the most appropriate approach to design of dewatering and depressurization systems for underground mines with mud rush issues?
Tough question. Mud rush issues, it will be something to develop, but at the moment, similarly to the caved material in block caves, I think fragmented material underground, the control you have, we don't have a lot of information on that. So perhaps there are some trigger for existing block caves mines. As far as I know, it's the only type of mine operation that will face mud rush, or the main main operation. I'm not aware of any modeling that predict mud rush.
In my experience, the only software that's capable of doing that is mass flow software from a geotechnical perspective. So I'm not familiar of any coupled hydrogeological models that can simulate mud rush. It is possible to simulate mud rushes in the same way that you would simulate a mass wasting event, like a slope failure or a waste dump failure or a landslide. But those tend to be quite highly specialized geotechnical simulations in a block cave environment or an underground cave environment. So the best thing to do is to have a underground model that is well constrained and well defined in terms of predictions of inflow locations and rates, and then feed that information through to a geotechnical team who are then able to simulate the mud rushes independently. Do you agree with that, Farrell?
Yeah, you mentioned the software. There are different softwares that are simulating the flow of rock, basically. And that's what is producing the estimation of the subsidence zone, for instance. Yeah. I think for the specific case of mud rush, it's a local effect due to the accumulation of water. With a specific properties, you are at the base of a huge column of caved material, just above the draw point. It's a very specific problem. I'm not convinced. If you don't have a good understanding of the stress, the condition, let's say 25 or 50 meters above your extraction level. And also a very good understanding of the condition of saturation of your material, I'm not convinced you can simulate the mud rush.
Thanks, Florent. Another question from Mertkan Ozbakir. He's asking, saying that model domains for environmental impact assessments generally cover extremely large areas. If building a numerical model specifically for mine dewatering or slope depressurization, do you recommend modifying an EIA model domain to a lesser area, narrowing it down to the pit or underground that's going to be dewatered, or do you leave it as a more general regional model?
I would say I leave it as a regional model, and I would say that today, because it's possible with all the flexibility offered in terms of meshing, and that's something you can do. It's to start large and after focus on a specific area. So as you say, as a AIA model, it's generally very big catchment. You want to consider a very large area to have different receptors, perhaps quite far of the mine. So you start with a very large model. And the pit model for the slope depressurization and dewatering, it's very focused. It will include detailed information, block model. You try to be very precise. It's something you can do today with Modflow USG. You don't need anymore all the row and column that will limit you in the refinement of your pit. If you have a homogeneous grid for your impact assessment, after if you have a specific problem somewhere, you have the possibility to refine locally your model to adapt and refine the properties and the boundary condition in this area of interest. I'm sure you can use it for other purposes.
Thanks, Florent. Yeah, I think it's worth adding there that there's certainly no need to build a very big model if you're only worried about a certain pit or a certain aspect of a mine. It's quite possible to have a more focused model if you have a specific question that needs to be asked, or if you have an extremely complex pit area that would benefit from having a focused model built for it. So there's certainly no need to have one or the other. You can have both. But as Florent mentions, modern model codes are much more flexible with regards to being able to refine grid resolution and mesh resolutions in pit areas. So you can actually avoid rework by refining an existing EIA model rather than building a new model from scratch. I don't see any other questions at this stage. So thanks very much, and I hope you all enjoyed that. As I say, it is the last of our series, our mine water series of talks. We are looking at putting together a series of geotech-focused talks on the practical geotech for open pit slopes and waste dumps. We'll be advertising more of that information through the GSSA as and when we've got that nailed down. And we are also in the process of developing a course for practical mine water management that will be running in the near future. And we'll be sending out information on that as and when it becomes available. Thanks again to the GSSA, the Groundwater Division, and IAH South Africa for collaborating on the series of talks. And we very much appreciate it, to Nolene especially, for putting all the logistics and arrangements in place. And thanks again for joining us.
I'd just like to say, on behalf of the GSSA, thanks so much to Gus for organizing and moderating this mine water management series. I think everyone will agree that all of the talks have been highly informative. I'd also like to thank Pateau Associates for the sponsorship of all of our online talks for the month of August. So thank you guys very much, and we'll see you in the next one.
Thank you, Natalie. Much appreciated. And thanks again for putting on such a well-received series of talks. We've been getting comments from all over the world about how well the GSSA has done in putting these talks together. And I understand that there's been a lot of good feedback on the GSSA YouTube channel. So well done.
Perfect. We love the feedback.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Florent.
I'm going to end the meeting now. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks, everyone.